Hey guys, this is Dr. Joel coming at you with part 3 of 3 in the Complete Blood Count series. If you started on this video, you might want to back up and watch part 1 first. You can click on this link here to do that. Or if you've seen that video, you can click on this link to see part 2. In the current video, this is part 3, I'm going to be covering the platelets. And then I'm going to talk about the MPV, or the mean platelet volume. Then I'm going to talk about the CBC fishbone, which is a shorthand method to write out a CBC. You're definitely going to need to know that on your wards or your clinical rotations. And then I'll give 2 knowledge challenge questions or CBC examples that we can work through and talk about. All right, let's get started. This is the entire CBC that I started with, and so far in parts 1 and 2, I've talked about the white section and then the red section, the white blood cells and the red blood cells, and as promised, in this lecture, we're going to jump right into the platelets. Platelets are also referred to as thrombocytes, which is important later on when we talk about thrombocytosis or thrombocytopenia. They have a diameter of about 2 to 3 nanometers. And to help you get kind of a visual reference of how large this is, I'm going to add a backdrop of a red blood cell. Red blood cells have a diameter of about 8 nanometers or so. It's a good ruler if you're looking at a microscope slide to just say a red blood cell is 8 and then to judge other cells by that size. So you can see that they are considerably smaller than a red blood cell. Platelets are produced from megakaryocytes, which are large bone marrow cells with lobulated nuclei. Platelets, of course, are anuclear. They don't have a nucleus. They're formed from these megakaryocytes by just kind of budding off or being produced as blebs from the cell membrane of these megakaryocytes. The exact process is still being worked on, but it's enough to know that they bud off in such a fashion. Platelets, as we know, contribute to hemostasis, or our body's ability to stop bleeding. They work with the coagulation cascade to form a platelet plug, and they do this in 3 stages. First, they adhere to the endothelium that has been damaged. Then they activate themselves, and the picture on the right shows inactivated platelets on the top and activated platelets on the bottom. You can see that the activated platelets just look stickier, and that's because of the dendrites, or little fingers that they have coming out of them, that help them stick together and form that platelet plug. And then lastly, they aggregate, which means that more and more platelets come to the rescue, and they clump together and begin to form that plug. So now, having talked about what they are and a little bit about what they do, what do you think might be a cause for thrombocytosis, which is another way of saying an increased number or an increased count of platelets in the blood? And for a real quick side note, I don't have time to talk about these upcoming diseases in this lecture. If you want to learn more about those, you could click on the links and learn about them directly. In this lecture, again, we're just talking about the CBC. Okay. How about acute blood loss? Our body can sense acute blood loss, and to react to that, we can release more stored thrombocytes from the spleen, which acts as kind of a reservoir or a temporary storage. Chronic myelogenous leukemia is another one. Iron deficiency can actually cause a thrombocytosis. Polycythemia vera. And hyposplenism is another way of saying either you're missing a spleen or your spleen is working improperly. Now, next on to thrombocytopenia. What do you think could cause thrombocytopenia? Idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura. Try saying that 10 times fast. There's a couple of different diseases that kind of fall into that class. Next, what about HELLP syndrome, which is related in pathology to preeclampsia? Hemolytic uremic syndrome. And also disseminated intravascular coagulation, or DIC. All right, now into the MPV, which stands for the mean platelet volume. And that's just almost exactly what it sounds like. It is the calculated measurement of the platelet size. Now, one kind of cheat that you can use is that platelets' size often increases with an increased production, and vice versa. They'll often decrease with a decreased production. Again, it's not always the case, but it's just something that might help you if you get stuck. We use the MPV to help us figure out or to diagnose different causes of changes to the platelet production. It helps us get a good differential in our diagnosis. So, first off, what could cause an increase MPV? How about immune thrombocytopenic purpura? Or some of the myeloproliferative diseases? Bernard-Soulière syndrome? And preeclampsia. As for the decrease in the MPV, you might see that with aplastic anemia or some drugs that are toxic to the bone marrow cells, so cytotoxic drugs, and also in some certain viral infections, you could see that. And now that I've forced you to listen to all that, for a moment of honesty, pure honesty with you, I really don't look at the MPV very much. It's just not something that you look at in general practice. If you get into hematology, you might start looking at it, but for general practice, it's not really used that often. At least that's been my experience. And now let's talk about a little bit of shorthand. This is actually really common, and I would say that it's pretty much standardized when you write out the shorthand for a CBC. This is how it's going to look. You're going to have the hemoglobin and the hematocrit in the center with the white blood cell count on the left and the platelets on the right. And, you know, I use this. All my residents, all my attendings use it. Everyone that I've met uses this fishbone for the CBC. It's not the only fishbone, however. There are other fishbones or shorthands. So, for example, here's a couple of other ones. On the bottom left, you can see the basic metabolic profile shorthand. And this is also standard. I have never met anybody who doesn't use this shorthand. In the top middle, this is for the calcium, mag, and phosphate. I have seen this written in different ways, and so it's not as standardized. And the same goes with the coagulation studies in the upper right, the PTT and INR studies. They write those a little bit differently depending on where you're from. And then in the bottom right is the ABG shorthand, and that is pretty standard. I haven't seen anyone write that differently. Okay, if you want to learn more about those other studies there, you can click on those links and go check those out as well, all right? But pretty high yield, if you're going into a clinic, to at least know the left two shorthands for the CBC and the BMP, or the basic metabolic profile. All right, guys, congratulations. You've made it to the first knowledge challenge in the CBC series of videos. And if you've gotten this far after watching all three CBC videos, wow, good for you. I would have started watching Monster Truck videos a long time ago. So you go. So let's see, what do we have here? Well, let's say that someone brings this to you and conversationally they want to know what you're thinking. So this is the fishbone. This is the shorthand for the CBC. And I don't expect you to know 100% where everything is right away. And that's why I'm going to give you a cheat in the upper left-hand corner. So we can see that the white blood cell count is at 12.5. And the hemoglobin is at 14.9, the hematocrit at 46.2, and the platelets at 270. What the heck does that mean? What's normal? Well, again, I'm going to help you out. I'm going to put normal underneath the values. So what do you see? Well, the white blood cell count is too high. It's above normal. The hemoglobin is in normal range. The hematocrit is in normal range, and the platelets are in normal range. So right away, you know something's wrong with the white blood cells. They're too high. Usually this means there is an infection. Now, if you clinically know the patient and know the history, you could probably guess what kind of infection. However, if you had no clue what was going on, you might want to see the entire CBC just to see a breakdown of the white blood cells to give you a better idea of what kind of infection this patient might be fighting. So here it is. Here's that same CBC except printed out completely. Again, white blood cells are too high. What else is too high? Well, the neutrophils. The neutrophils are too high. If you remember back from the first lecture, we talked about neutrophils being high for things like an acute infection. What kind of infection, you ask? Well, is it going to be a parasitic infection? Is it going to be a viral infection? How about bacterial? You're probably going to see a high neutrophil count in an acute bacterial infection. For a parasitic infection, you'd probably expect the eosinophils to increase. And for a viral infection, lymphocytes, maybe some monocytes, those would increase. And then the basophils might increase with an allergic reaction of some kind. Next up, knowledge challenge number 2. See if you can figure this one out without using the cheats. Cheat number 1 and cheat number 2. Okay, so what do we got? Well, we know that the white blood cells are in normal range, so it's probably not an infection of any kind. However, the hemoglobin and the hematocrit are too low. So this is an anemic patient. The platelets are also a little bit high. It's normal range, but they're a little bit high. So that's something to think about. What do you think is going on? Well, again, if you knew the patient's history, if you knew a little bit about the patient, you might be able to make a guess as to what kind of anemia you're looking at. However, if you have no idea, you're going to want the entire lab slip. So here it is. Here's the entire lab slip. Go right to the red blood cell section or the red section. And I'll be honest with you, the workup of anemia based on lab values is a lecture in and of itself because there are several different causes of anemia and it's kind of tricky to work through when you're first learning. A little bit of practice and you'll be an old pro at it. Let me give you a couple of pointers here. So we know, okay, let's look at the MCV. The MCV is telling us that the mean corpuscular volume is a little bit low. So, and the same with the mean corpuscular hemoglobin. So the body is, it's having a hard time making red blood cells. It's not just that you've bled out and you have a decreased hemoglobin because you have an acute bleed. In fact, at the source, in the bone marrow, your body is having a hard time making hemoglobin. All right, and so that gives you a little bit of a clue. This is, in fact, an example of iron deficiency anemia. And I could only really know that if I did further iron studies. But if I didn't do the other iron studies, what else could it be? This is a microcytic anemia. Well, it could be one of the thalassemias, or maybe an anemia of chronic inflammation, or a sideroblastic anemia. Again, working up anemia is a little bit more complex than just getting a CBC, but I think you get the idea, okay? This is an anemic patient, and the problem is in production, not blood loss, okay? I'm going to put a link up here at the top where you can go see a lecture that's just devoted to figuring out the anemias. If you've got time, you can check that out. So good job on this second knowledge challenge. Hey, thanks for sticking around, guys. I hope you liked this lecture. If you did, please give me a like. The likes keep me motivated. I need to feel the energy to keep on going. Like I said, I got a day job. I'm a resident, so I mean, this is my extra time here. Subscribe. I'm putting out new videos as fast as I can. And lastly, give me a comment. Let me know what you think. And I do my best to get back to everybody. All right? Thanks, guys. Good luck in school.